radio, in TV.
Remember, all I'm offering is the truth, nothing more.
I'm a relationship hack.
Run up and get touched up, suicide. And all of y'all know my style. I excel, then prevail. Run up and get touched up, suicide, that's it. And all of y'all know my style.
Ladies and gentlemen, the ZOWHAT Morning Show is back in the building. June 27th. We've got another heater. I don't know whose heart this is on the microphone. Maybe all types of people in here. Weird shows. It could belong to somebody. I don't know. Anyway, today's topic is about to be incredible. Yes. The show is about to be jam-packed. I am so excited right now. But you know what I got to do before anything else? I got to support black businesses. I've got to support black businesses. The first business I'm going to get out there, I got to do this right now. My Indiegogo page for my next book, The Holographic Relationship, A Deeper Look into Spirituality and Intimate Relationships. So many so-called relationship experts, and that's why call myself a relationship expert. I can never be an expert of your relationship. Never. And no one can, right? But so many of those experts miss one crucial thing, the spiritual element. If you listen to most relationship specialists and gurus, they're talking about getting in alignment with social norms and standards, right? That don't make you a relationship expert. That makes you a sociologist. And most people don't know, when you're talking about relationships, you're talking about a spiritual school where the curriculum in that interaction is your university. And most people don't understand that. This book, The Holographic Relationship, is going to be an amazing work. I'm so excited. I'm combining concepts from quantum physics, philosophy, all of the ancient religious scrolls. I mean, it's going to be a very powerful work. If you want to help me bring it into fruition, get to my Indiegogo page. Please pull it up one more time. I'm waiting, Thor. Thank you. Pull it up. Thor's a white man in the studio. He just has long hair. I call him Thor. I'm sorry. Pull it all the way up so they can see the picture so they'll know what it looks like. All the way up. That is the new Indiegogo crowdfunding campaign for The Holographic Relationship, A Deeper Look into the Spiritual Meaning Behind Intimate Communion, a very powerful book. Now, on to the next. Zoe's got new t-shirts with the ZOWHAT logo, Go Deeper. Very, very fly. It's this metallic silver. It's kind of reflective when you get out in the sun. That's one design. And then the secondary design, the ZOWHAT logo here for the radio, the ZOWHAT Show radio logo. I've only got, I only have four sizes, XL, double XL, triple XL, and quadruple XL. Just come on in here. All right, so please continue to get those. The only way to get these, you have to go to my PayPal account, I guess. My email for PayPal is, what is it? ZoeWilliamsOrders@gmail.com. ZoeWilliamsOrders@gmail.com. The shirt is $30. The shirts are $30. And I've only got 40 pieces. So you got to move on those right now. I've only got 40 pieces to give out. $30. That includes shipping and handling. Get at me ASAP. Very limited amount. Also, if you don't know already, I want him to talk about it. He's sitting right here. I mean, he's standing right here. The GODBOX. Pull up the iTunes pre-order real quick. If you don't get David Banner's latest album, The GODBOX, it's not available yet. Pre-order. Pre-order it right now. This is what it looks like on iTunes. David.
Yeah.
Tell me, man. First off, welcome to the show. But tell me what this album means, how important it is that we get behind it. What message are you sending, bro?
Well, this is what I tell people. The message is about going inward. The thing is Erykah Badu taught me something that I never forget. I try not to describe my album because you don't know how the Most High is working with the consumer.
Right.
And I know how Pac made me feel. And if Pac came and described his album and it wasn't how I was feeling at the time, then it breaks that connection between me and the Most High or the way that that album made me feel. So all I tell people is one of the dopest hip-hop albums in history. And I always tell people this. I say, like, people always say they want better music, but I don't believe that. They just want it from who they want it from. You know what I'm saying? And the thing that I also realize is we said we want these kids to be better and rap better, then show them better.
Right.
If the GODBOX sells 2 million copies, then kids going to say, how can I get 2 million copies sold? I'm going to have to start rapping like David Banner.
Right. Right.
And in order for you to start rapping like David Banner, you're going to have to read a damn book.
I'm just being honest with you. And they can pre-order right now?
They can pre-order it right now. They can get Before the GODBOX anywhere that you pick up mixtapes. All Hip Hop said it was one of the best mixtapes and one of the most relevant hip hop mixtapes in history. And you can get that anywhere. It's funny, I had a we had a record with Jasiri X and Minister Farrakhan, and a lot of the I'd say white so-called hip hop mixtape sites took it off. Mysteriously.
It wasn't mysterious.
Yeah.
You
have to put mysteriously in there. You know, so the people want to get. But you know, yeah, you know what it is.
Right.
So what I tell people all the time is, and also I say people always pat me on my back and they say they thank me for me being active, and I always tell them you have to thank me because I'm a grown man and this is my community. This is what I'm supposed to do.
Right.
But I said if you do want to thank me, buy something.
How about it?
Like spend some money.
How about it?
And the GODBOX, and, you know, Before the GODBOX is here, and Zoe, thank you.
Come on, man. Come on now. Now, we got a couple of sisters in here. They got some events that they're promoting and supporting. Really quickly, sister, tell them your name and tell them the event you're representing.
My name is Koshana Kwaylee, and we are celebrating the return of the gods, the real family reunion.
Is this like my birthday party?
This is your birthday party. This is all of our birthday party. We are rising as an African people, like Brother David Banner just spoke on, and ZOWHAT, everything that you guys are doing. This is time to celebrate that. Celebrate this global African awakening. Yes. I am so happy to be a part of this movement. And to have divine brothers like you guys supporting it. So,
do you guys have a video for it? We got a video for this right now. Let's get a quick minute shot of this video so you can see what this event actually entails. Go there.
Return of the God.
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 The real family reunion, Return of the God.
Saturday, July 2nd, Point Furman Park, San Pedro, California, overlooking the Pacific Ocean. Live African and hip-hop dancers, yoga demonstrations, and so much more. Motivational speakers, Reverend Michael Beckwith, Kateria Knowles, Koshana Kwaylee, Grasshopper the Showstopper, Herb Alchemist, Okira Damani, Tiffany Janae, and Ethiopian Kundalini. Performances by Roz G and the African Space Program, Rain Morton, The Golden Nubian, Prince Chrono, The Incredible Pindu, and more. Honorary guests, Sanu Phil Valentine, Chef Kidi Uwadu, and others. Come dressed in gold and white to this royal celebration.
Hey, royal family, this is Flex Alexander. I'll see you at the Real Family Reunion, Return of the Gods.
Get your tickets now at therealfamilyreunion.org.
Wow, that seems like an interesting little event. I'm going to be there. I got my little special tickets. Hold on.
Big event.
Pow! Look at this. I'm going to be in the building. Y'all come down and holler at your brother. Zoe Williams will be out there to support this event. You're right, David. This is a big event. This is not a small event. This is something for us to come together and commune with each other. I'll be there for sure. Thanks, ladies, for supporting this for us. Thank you.
Thank you. And that's right. July 2nd, everybody come out, Point Furman Park. Children 12 and under are free. Get your tickets now because they're $10 more at the door. Peace and love.
And then our caterer is in the building today. What's up, young lady?
Hello, hello.
What did you make us to eat?
Jambalaya, cornbread, and a little salad.
Yeah! Yes. It's on and cracking. Where do people connect to your business?
My name is Taylor Campbell. I'm the owner and founder of TaylorMade Cuisine. I specialize in neo soul food. It's basically a new way of eating your comfort food in a healthier, more way. So I'm on Facebook, Instagram. I'm everywhere. I'm located in the South Bay area of Los Angeles, but I can come anywhere.
I'm going to tell you, Keith David was in here eating her food, and he was like, what's your number?
Right.
Is there any more of that?
Right.
It was delicious. I don't know what you made that day.
Chicken and red beans and rice.
Yeah, man. She's an incredible caterer. Yes. Please go support the sisters' movement. Also, I am wearing the Rammelmark bomber jacket. Ugh. Pull up the Rammelmark site. Jesus. These jackets will be available, I think, in the next couple of weeks. You'll be able to go on his website and check them out. This is the Rammelmark high fashion, high-end, cultural, art, design. I mean, it's all of it. Wearing his clothes is like wearing a museum, right? You talk about people who lack knowledge of self or whatever. Trust me, it's like wearing a museum. And it's crazy. I really don't want to get too deep on this brother right now, because I may say something that might be bad. It might be perceived as bad, but it's not really bad. Let me just say it like this. There are a lot of designers out there who are struggling. So guess what they got to do? They got to hire white models. So the white model wears the gear and attracts the white consumer. Because the black people are saying, that costs too much. Can I get the hookup? Brother, what's happening? You know, they doing them like that, but the white man is saying, hey, fuck it. If you don't want to claim Egypt, I will. And I'll pay $5,000 for that purse. Or how, I don't know if the purse costs $5,000, but it's expensive. But at the same time, this is the, paradoxically speaking, we'll go and sacrifice all type of shit to go buy Gucci, to go buy Versace. This dude created a high-end clothing line that turned knowledge of self into a living museum on your ass. And you want to complain about how much it costs when you will kill another nigga if he scrape your Air Force Ones. I'm just saying. You feel me? Right. We got to support this brother.
My stuff is never going on sale. I'm serious. I'm serious because what we basically saying is that we don't see value in self.
Right.
And we'll stop our kids from eating to go get some Gucci. Ooh. And Louis Vuitton, one of the head people in Louis Vuitton, just said that black people eat like what they said.
I remember that
like
little shit. Yeah,
you know, said very derogatory things about our people, and we kill ourselves to lie.
Michael Kors did it. Donna Karen did it. All of them keep saying, fuck you niggas. Crystal, why you drinking our shit? They don't fuck with us, but we fuck with them because they give us meaning. Now that's just shit. I'm sorry.
Wow.
Antonio Moore told me to tell you about this book by Louis Eldridge, Capitalism, The New Segregation. Listen, this is just a community empowerment segment. We ain't even started the show yet. Right? Capitalism, The New Segregation. What is the impact? I don't even want to give it away. I'm going to keep this book for myself. Please support this brother, all right? Please support this book, The New Segregation. Capitalism, The New Segregation. Here you go, bro. My man right here, David Banner, does not bullshit when it comes to the books. Also, Shepherd Family Suites. I'm saying the name wrong. It's shepherdsuites.com. Please pull up the website. This is bona fide legal crack. This candy is available. It's organic. It's non-GMO. It's all of that. But when I tell you this toffee candy, she asked me to bring the sweet potato cake in here. But I was like, I'm not carrying all that shit. I can't. But when I tell you this candy is cocaine in a jar, it really is. White chocolate, zebra crunch, all that shit. It's really incredible. Please pull up the website one more time. Shepherdsuites.com is the name of the website. We have a couple more things to promote. We got about a minute left. Easy Boy Web. These guys did my website. The guy who runs the entire operation, his name is Landon. Landon Williams, please continue to support this brother's work. He does great work. He's a professional. And man, just go there. If you have any website or any, you know, apps, all of that, he does it all. E-commerce, smart guy, does great work. Also, we've got Wanda on the phone. Let's get Wanda on the phone real quick from Mind Blowing Mobiles. This sister did my app. Her apps are the best apps in the world. I was getting notifications. I posted a video talking crap on Facebook this morning, like, y'all don't miss the show, goddammit. This shit gonna be crazy. And then she sent out a push notification that sent everybody who downloaded my app, who uses it, to the video in real time. Like, she is not a game. Wanda Trotter, get on here and tell us about Mind Blowing Mobiles.
Good morning. I'm so excited to see your show today.
It's gonna be crazy. You already know, right?
Yes, yes. You know David Banner, that's my homie there from Mississippi.
Oh, you from Mississippi too, girl? Yeah. All right. So tell them really quickly how they connect with you, how they work with you. What's the deal?
MindblowingMobile.com is my website. My email is Wanda@MindblowingMobile.com. And we are more than happy to help anybody build their business. Today we're offering that one-time coupon again. We got some people who requested it last time, which was June 6th. Mm-hmm. So we're going to offer it today through your mobile app, and it's only going to be available through the show and 1 hour after the show.
Well, there it is. Thank you so much, Wanda. We appreciate you. And before I leave, I have one more business to promote. I want you to pull up their website right now. I'm going to do this one more time. This is Cash Mob Mondays. We've got a Cash Mob, all of the businesses that I have featured today. Elephant has just given a ZOWHAT code, ZOWHAT show code. Let me read the damn text. A ZOWHAT, pull up Elephant, 30% off. You hear me? 30% off for ZOWHAT fans. All of these businesses are being promoted for free, guys. I want to see these businesses win. All of them are being looked out for free, right? But no, pull it back up there. I want people to see that. Pull it back up there. The coupon code is ZOWHAT. A lot of people complained about these guys out of New York. High level. If you like Polo and Ralph Lauren and all that, they do it in the same factory with the same materials. But because it don't have a white man riding a horse with a little helmet on, y'all be like, fuck that. But it's the same quality.
Right.
But brothers make it. But because there ain't no little pony rider on it, it ain't shit. Okay, Elephant, 30% off. ZOWHAT is the coupon code. And I got to take a break, but when we come back, the show about to get lit up in this motherfucker this evening. We'll be back at 2.2 ZOWHAT Morning Shows, T Radio V. That's radio and TV. We'll be back. Deuces.
Hey, my nigga. Why you call yourself that? Hey, my nigga. You supposed to be a god. Hey, my nigga. Why you call yourself?
You are watching T Radio V. Radio in TV.
Relationship Dismount is a book that I created. A breakup and makeup book. But what's interesting about this particular book is I used gymnastics to come up with a concept based off of sticking the landing. Everybody knows that in a gymnast's routine, one of the most important and crucial to the success of that routine is how they end it, how they finish it. And I decided to come up with the concept of relationship dismount using this metaphor. Sticking the landing, how you end it is how you begin it moving forward. So we wanted to take that metaphor and really expound on it in the context of intimate relationships.
LA Street Angel.
my talk show here in the middle of Hollywood, so come hang out with me, learn some awesome, new, cool, spiritual stuff, and it's every Thursday, 1 o'clock Pacific time, tradiob.com.
LA Street Angel, call to heal these streets.
Hey geeks, wake up, we've got big news. I'm not gonna mumble this time. Geekscape, the long-running movie video game... Let me do one more. Hey geeks, we got big news! Geekscape, your favorite show about movies, video games, comics, and TV, is coming to T-Radio V Monday, October 6th. And it'll be on every Monday from then on, 7 p.m. Until the apocalypse happens, we're all eaten by zombies.
Hi, I'm Ty Simpkins.
Miss Danielle Basuti.
Hi, this is Brooke Peoples.
I'm Jocelyn Donahue.
Hi, I'm Keegan Allen, and you're watching
T-Radio V.
T-Radio V.
T-Radio V, radio in TV.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Yes.
T-Radio V. Yo.
T-Radio V. Radio in TV.
Radio in TV.
You are watching T-Radio V. Radio in TV.
White guy like me co-hosting a black radio show. I think toxic relationships cause you to take poor care of yourself. That if you can recognize danger, if you can pause, if you can take some breaths, refocus, and engage, you might be able to dodge a bullet that you're going to send or coming towards you. One of the things that men don't get is that often women need to vent first to clear their mind. So today's show, if I'm reading correctly, the Puffyization of a Black America, why hasn't Black America's stars, entertainers changed for 25 years? So here's the white man's spin on this thing. I know you can hardly wait.
Right.
You can hardly wait to trash it.
It's a bated breath.
Here's the issue, not just in the black community, but in the world. It seems like people know two things. You can either be afraid or you can be angry. And why people pick anger is because at least you're in motion. You know, if you're afraid and it gets bad, you panic, you freeze, and that doesn't, you can't do anything. But if you get angry, even if you get enraged, you can at least be in motion. May destroy the hell out of your life, but you can be in motion. Here's what the other alternative is, and this is what the ZOWHAT show is all about. You can get smart instead of be afraid or be angry. One of the things that I do that's been part of my personal growth is I always push myself out of my comfort zone to the point where I'm afraid and about to panic, but I never panic. I just get smart. But I'm going to die with a smile on my face one of these days because I push myself too far and I discovered the secret to peace on earth, but I will have dropped dead from a massive heart attack. So, but the key is what you want to do is get smart. And when I coach people, what I do is know that you're reacting, feel the reaction inside, and then I say downshift. And if you drive a stick shift car, there's a difference between downshift when you're going around a curve and stepping on the accelerator. You step on the accelerator, you're off the cliff. But when you downshift, you grab traction. You grab into the road. You pull it towards you. You can manage it. And I also push people, have as many experiences in life as you can, because when you downshift, what'll happen is if you don't blow it up and make it worse, you're going to pull from hundreds of thousands of experiences, all the answers, but if you either run it away or pedal to the metal, you're going to miss them all.
You knew we had a special guest on today, huh?
Mm-hmm. Can't wait.
And you decided to just get long-winded, didn't you? Well, we love you anyway.
Well, in post-production. Hey, cut me out in post-production.
Ladies and gentlemen, you already know what it is. The BET Awards was last night. It was one of the blackest BET Awards we have seen in a while. And I think it's important for us to deal with this discussion. It was Antonio Moore who brought it to my attention. He said, do you know all of the major stars in hip hop were born in 69? He said, what happened in 96 that just capped it off? I said, what do you mean capped it off? He said, man, the game changed in 96, right? Listen, look at Kevin Hart. How long Kevin Hart been a comedian before he blew up? 19, 20 years? Mm-hmm. How long was Steve Harvey a comedian before he blew up? Mm-hmm. 20, 30 years? Mm-hmm. I mean, Steve Harvey said himself, I didn't start getting money until I was, what, 44, 45 mm-hmm. years old, right? What is it that kind of caps us off and leaves us with what I call stereotypical benchmarks to attain in entertainment? I want to be the next Puffy, or I want to be the next Dre, right? It's almost like we're locked in those lanes when it comes to entertainment. And we want to get into it today. We got a lot of heavy questions. We want to talk about the state of the Black community, hip-hop's effect on it, hip-hop's impact on it. And it's going to be very, very powerful. So with that said, everybody, Bobby, Kevin, Antonio, Doc G, Jeff Brown, and the homie
to the right,
David Banner, my in man. The building.
My man.
And in 5 minutes, Kumo D is calling
you
in
are
too.
Not yeah, it's about to go down. To me
we
today.
Need to answer questions.
What?
So let me just ramble off a few questions. Is hip hop culture pro nuclear family? That's a tough question to ask, but we're going to need answers to it. True or false, the great majority of hip-hop culture leans towards bigamy and misogynistic attitudes. Ugh. Is hip-hop culture anti-family or community? Is it really money, power, respect? I just got to get mine, fuck yours? Or is that just an act? We need to speak on it. Why is the Black community so disjointed, so broken? Why is self-hate still a powerful influencer in the African-American community? And how does Great Britain's exit from the EU affect you, nigga? I want to know. It's important. Do you even care about Great Britain leaving the EU? It means something to me. We need to talk about it right now. Let's get into it. Let's start with old Henri and get it going. Bobby?
Old Henri.
That's my man. I got to tell him the truth.
Well, you know, you touched on something right off the top this now. And the Brexit situation. Everybody that's listening to this show that has a 401k, whether you just started or you're on the back end of it, you're short this morning. And the reason that's important is we have not really begun to understand the financial aspects of wealth building from a collective standpoint. A lot of people have collected money individually, but in terms of our mutual benefit, where is our money located? It's parked in somebody else's yard. Mm. And in this instance, it's going to be very, very impactful, because as soon as that deck of cards starts to fall, who always gets hit first? It's going to be us. And the fact that we're not even paying attention to it other than this show, and that's why I'm glad people are tuning into this show. I'm glad this brother's here today, because he's a walking example of his generation's example of self-determination. So with respect to that particular issue, pay more attention to what you think is far away from you. Those chickens are coming home to roost.
David, anybody? Who wants to jump in? Antonio? Go ahead, Jeff, and then okay. Antonio.
I got the same damn question. What if everybody black blank? What if everybody black?
Here we go.
Said, you know what, collectively? Fuck our 401ks. We're all going to take the money out. And the 401ks and the money, what we're purely going to do is hire black people in poor neighborhoods to turn their backyards into farmland. Just throw that out there. Came to me while I was high.
A lot of your
can
stuff.
Can I add something to that? Yeah. I think when we say all, we place a stigma on it. We don't need all. If we could get 10%, let's put a very specific, tangible number on it.
Yeah, yeah.
Because when we say all, subliminally, a lot of black people are saying, well, shit,
ain't everybody gonna do that shit.
I can't get two motherfuckers to do something. the thing that I'm starting to realize, and I haven't said this in a lot of places, but even rappers, they want to be platinum. I want to show y'all something. Pull out your calculators really quick. I have a hoodie, like I was telling you about, right?
Yeah.
Hoodie costs $75. Put $75 in there, right? I don't want but 50,000 fans times 50,000. What is that? Tell me what number.
$3,750,000.
For a $75 hoodie. All we need is 50,000 fans. Really, all you need is 20,000.
Wow.
So so instead of us saying, what if all black people, let's just say if we got 10,000 black people or we got 20,000 black people to do anything at the same time.
At the same damn time.
Wow. Bro, that's powerful when you see it.
When you see it.
Let me tell you something really quick. As it pertains to business, I am free now and more powerful than I've ever been in my whole entire career, and most people don't even see me. When I figure out, instead of waiting for somebody to believe that I'm hot, I started renting buildings. Like, literally, most of my lecture series, like, there's anywhere from 500 to 1,000 people in any lecture that I throw at $25 a head. Do you know how powerful that is? And then we turn around and we hire people from the community. People said, you walk in the building like you Farrakhan. You got security everywhere. I said, it's not as much that I think somebody's going to do something for me, but why not hire four people from the Nation of Islam? Why not hire four people from the actual, you know, police station?
Yeah, yeah.
Four people from the community, some of the new Black Panther Party, and you pay these different people. When I went back to Jackson, it may not sound like much, but just for my lecture alone, I put $7,500 back into the community. That may sound small, but for people who are not getting over $28,000 a year annually, that means something. So I think all we have to do in any of these movements, I was even telling somebody, like what happened to Mike Brown. Let's just say if me and Zoe got together and built a statue for Mike Brown. And let's say to the people, we said we raising money. It don't matter how much money we really raise to get the statue done, because me and you going to pay for it anyway.
Right.
We have to get, all black people really want is a win. Think about the last time we ever really got a tangible win. Not like, okay, OJ free. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about a win that you can write down on paper, not the Obama I won't hope win.
Ooh.
You know? I'm talking about a
not
real
the symbolic win.
Yeah. Not the praying win.
Antonio Morris, get in here.
So I brought this concept to Zoe because it's something that I've covered before. And the book that he brought up earlier, the gentleman kind of quoted it, called Capitalism and New Segregation. He quoted one of my pieces called The Decadent Veil. And, you know, what I talk about there is this concept of the win, kind of like what David is presenting right there, where there's a decadent veil over black America. And that veil has been set in place since about 95.
Wait. Break that down. Decadent veil.
Yes, a veil.
Explain that.
So basically, there's a few black celebrities that are set out like carrots, from LeBron James and Puff Daddy. And essentially, they've been in place for about 25 to 30 years. And I'm not saying they actively know that their role is to create a veil over the fact that black America in large part is suffering. But their role in a large part is to make it seem like wealth is diverse when in actuality wealth is not diverse. And you can check that piece out on Huffington Post. You also should pick this man's book up. He hit me up on Twitter, and he had actually quoted my piece. But coming back to the puffyization of black America, what you start to have as a result of that puffyization, and we'll get into the legality of why that happened, is black America forgets itself and starts to blame itself for structural failures. So you, Mike Brown, ain't no jobs in your community. So you say, well, I don't need a job because I'm going to be puffy tomorrow. And so, like,
wow. Puffy becomes the benchmark, the aspiration.
He becomes a lot of things. He becomes the daddy that ain't there. Ooh. He becomes the white man's way to deal with what Jesse Williams presented. Get communities to buy Sprite and drink that shit till you fall out. He becomes a lot of things.
He becomes the Obama where they can say that there's no excuse or racism.
Yeah.
We're in a post-racial society because we have Obama, and Obama is just one person and is an oddity within itself. They use exceptions as the rule, and that's one of the ways to confuse people.
Wow. Kev?
Yeah, that's I'll call that the black privilege thing, whereas, you know, white people have their white privilege. They select a few black people, or quote-unquote black people, you know, to put above the rest of the crowd, and then that's who you're going to look to. that kind of started to me back when they tried to shut down the Black Panthers, because the Black Panthers, they were doing everything positive, feeding people, teaching people how to read, clothing them,
and protecting them.
And because they knew. But see, the thing with the Black Panthers, though, and also this started the NRA movement, their mash for guns. But see, the Black Panthers understood law, and they could stand in front, they could stand on the corner with a gun and tell the police, "Fuck you, pig," because they understood the law. So from that movement, when they did the COINTELPRO and put everybody in and tried and imploded the movement, then you had a lot of these little young people, especially the little young kids who were coming up, and they had nowhere else to put that energy. So then that's when they put Superfly. That's literally when Superfly came out, like maybe a year or two right after that, after the movement shut down. Mm. So then they put him. Look at this is the dude you want to be, the gangster white wall,
yeah.
the dude who can tell you, who tell white bitches this and that. And so this is where everybody focused.
Afro my ass, yeah. Relax your hair.
relax your hair. And so this is where everybody started to put their attention. Oh, I want to be like that. Forget the coming together shit. Mm. I want to be like that motherfucker who is over everybody else. So
listen, we got to take a quick break, but when we come back, it ain't over. We just getting started. What the fuck is the telecom app?
Yeah, we got to get into that.
Right? What is that? And how did that put a ceiling on the emergence of new ideas and new concepts and new people to follow? And also, we want to talk about the Black male super predator. Is that a byproduct of the Clinton administration? And Ooh. Will Hillary's administration be a replay of the shit Bill put in effect?
But Black people have to find out what Bill did. Most Black people don't think he did nothing to play the fucking saxophone.
Hey, wait a minute. That was our first Black president. Don't talk shit about Bill.
He smoked dope, played a saxophone, and cheated on his wife. That's a Black man.
That's a Black man. We'll be back at 2.2, the ZOWHAT Morning Show. We're taking a break.
You know,
and there wasn't that kind of variety.
Knowing of one large radio station company that also is a concert promoter. And if an artist was coming into that market and that concert was not being promoted by that company, that radio station, or with the appropriate format, did not play the records of that artist at that time.
When you're working for a station manager who's a radio person, some of what you'll find is, in many cases, during this time, they would stick up for the radio side of things. They would then say, no, we're gonna keep our playlist a little farther open. What you found with the business people is that it was a business. So their job was to keep their job. And what they end up doing is they'll say, okay, we can't play, for example, the Dixie Chicks because of what they said about George Bush. We can't play that because we don't want the parent corporation to come down on us. So we'll just eliminate them.
Some of the companies that grew up and have hundreds of radio stations now, as opposed to when there was a limit of 12 AM, 12 FM, and 12 TV, they continue to acquire stations and they'll jettison markets that aren't working for them, which kind of leaves a void. Sometimes stations have been allowed to go off the air because they couldn't find a buyer.
The trends continued after the first decade, without a doubt. But one of the things that I talked about this earlier, technology came into play. Now, the idea of what they call voice tracking, and I don't know if you've heard of that, but voice tracking is basically, I'm in, let's say, Los Angeles. I can now put my voice over a track in Delaware, okay? And what then can end up happening is, I can then eliminate the person who's doing that show because I don't necessarily need that person because this person can do 20 or 30 different stations across the country doing the same thing. All you have to do is send him the playlist and then he'll say, that was, this is, da 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 da, boom, 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 boom. And you can send it across the internet and boom, it's there at the station.
The net effect of that has not been good for the overall audience. Radio and television stations are licensed in the public interest. And in many cases, these large companies are acting more in their own interest than the public interest.
You are watching T Radio V, radio in TV.
I'm Zoe Williams.
And I'm Dr. Mark Goulston.
I'm Jeff Brown.
And we make up the Zoe What Morning Show. You can find us here on TRadioV.com every Monday at 11 a.m. Pacific Standard Time. I make you think.
He makes you laugh. And if I get a chance, I'll help you change.
Or make you cry with his attempts at humor.
Radio NTV.
Can you relate? We'll make it happen.
Look at Jeff. What you doing?
Were you mumbling to yourself?
Hey, back there mumbling.
To them. To them.
Yo, what's up? This is your boy Kyle Mass, and you're checking out T-Radio V.
T-Radio V. T-Radio V.
Hello, T-Radio V. Love you guys.
Radio in TV.
Radio in TV.
Hi, I'm Bob Nalbandian, and be sure to watch my show Inside Metal, which airs live every Tuesday from 3 to 4 p.m. Pacific Standard Time right here on T-Radio V. I'm going to be bringing in the greatest heavy metal artists live right here in the studio. Once again, every week at 3 p.m. Pacific Standard Time every Tuesday right here at TRadioV.com. Radio in TV.
You're watching T-Radio V. Radio in TV.
Thought you was my homeboy, man. Hey, my nigga.
Why you call yourself that?
Hey, my nigga.
You supposed to be a god.
Hey, my nigga.
Why you call yourself that?
Hey, my nigga.
GODBOX.
You supposed to be a god.
Pre-order right now.
Hey,
iTunes. What? Turn it up. Yeah.
Oh my god.
Hey, get that right now. Pre-order iTunes. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the Zo What Morning Show. Turnups is real.
Say it again.
Oh, they need to follow us. Oh, wait a minute. I'm confused. That's what he said. That's what. Could you rewind that again? That one line. Rewind it a little bit. Did he say fuck Tom Ford and everybody?
Oh my god.
Fuck Tom Ford. Fuck Versace. Yeah, said it on good.
Yeah. Hey, turn it up. Come on.
Stuff that we've been talking about on the show is on the top.
And what's funny?
This is what's funny, bro.
I got Trinidad James to do the hook, because I never heard nobody say nigga like him. He said nigga!
and it literally, it took me 6 years for stepping away from music to figure out how to do what I'm doing now. Because one thing that I'm not going to do is be whack. Wow. You know, and I tell people that all the time. One of the problems with so-called conscious music is that the shit sucks. They say that kids don't want positive music, but that shit is not jamming. Right. I don't care what kind of music you do, we hear 808 and think that's the devil. Like, no, it's not evil. It's not any type of music until you put your spirit over the top of it.
Mm.
Like, so just because kids can do this on the music, don't like, all, I call it the Big Mac syndrome.
Mm.
Like, if you put some salsa on top of it, they try to market that towards the homies. You know what I'm talking about? If they put bacon on it, they try to give it to black folks. They put a box of wine next to it, they say it's for white folks.
Wow. Mm.
You know what I'm saying? But at the end of the day, it's fucking bread, special sauce, lettuce, cheese. Whatever you put in the middle of that motherfucker. Because at the end of the day, I knew when I made that song, all the kids going to hear is, my nigga. but when they high and they driving home,
you heard what that nigga said.
They gonna hit the end of it. Why you call yourself that? You supposed to be a god. Oh shit, David Banner tricked me. That shit jammed.
Yeah.
You feel me?
I love
so,
it.
So
snuck some knowledge.
Get a propaganda to the proper goose.
Yeah.
But so my question now becomes this. How do we collectively unify, form that economic fist that propels Banner to the Puffy status, to the Jay-Z status? Is it possible? Doc G, then Antonio, because Antonio doesn't believe it. I mean, I like to set Antonio up.
The biggest challenge that I'm hearing, and I want to hear everyone, How do you get people to actually focus and stay focused? Because people, you can get them all riled up and want to do something. You came up with a great idea, David, to do a business with Zoe. But the point is, how do you get people to say, I'm going to make that a number one priority, and every day I'm going to pay attention to it, and I'm going to stick with it until I get through it? Because it's so easy for people to just lose their focus. They get scattered. Someone's pulling at
them. You just said low-key black people lazy.
I have a dark, horrible answer to that.
And that's kind of like why this is important with the Telecommunications Act of 96, is that we went from having like hundreds to maybe even thousands of people that owned radio stations to six companies. And when those six companies control media, they control your mind. So in no way do I feel that David Banner's music is I haven't heard it to make a judgment. But I feel like what we're missing is that the engine that created Will Smith, the engine that created Puff Daddy, has basically gutted itself, and now is just regurgitating the same talent.
Okay.
And so, like, we're at a point where I don't know if there's an investment interest by the business people at Viacom to say, David Banner, I want you to tell us that Tom Ford's clothing sucks. Jesse Williams, that's his name, Jesse Williams, right?
Yeah.
Jesse Williams, I don't want to put you on the stage at the Grammys. Because what you said at the BET Awards, we know you're going to bring that to the Grammys. Shut that down. So there's a control mechanism that's in place now to keep these messages from hitting our ears.
Man, does that sound like... Okay.
The answer to the question...
Banner.
Okay.
The answer to the question, how do we do that? We do it through saturation and consistency. We got here through saturation and consistency. And I'm going to touch on what David said earlier. We really started backtracking a little bit and start with what we got. And then you just build on it, momentum. It's not just them saying they're going to do it. It's about doing that and replicating that. And then just kind of, in a sense, lower our expectation on a certain level, but we do it consistently. I'm sitting here right now, be 62 next month, and I heard what he said, and it connected me to Gil Scott-Heron. It connected me to other cats who came before them. And we were moved as a generation. Did nobody anoint Gil? Gil anointed himself to say the revolution would not be televised. And now we still morphing off of that 50 years later. So what we do is we just put that light on this brother right here, and we feed him and we fuel him, and we replicate these relationships. That's the answer to how we do that.
Banner, then
go
ahead.
Really? Okay.
He said, really? You go
pass? Yeah. actually, when how do we do it? I'm kind of agreeing with you, but I say that we don't. The complaint with regard to Viacom and the Giants makes about as much sense as going, you know what? I really don't like the way they shoe these horses anymore. Well, guess what, motherfucker? We drive cars. So who cares? There's the internet. The internet. All you have to do is get 1 million people to give you a dollar. The internet is here. The big dinosaurs are just that. They are. We see them standing up because of how slow they're falling. That's it. They're gone. They're just falling slow. Okay. So the concept that I need to try to watch out for the Grammys because of what I said on BET, dude, the genie's out of the bottle. Do you know how I found out about what dude said? I don't have BET. I got Hulu and Netflix. Nigga, I saw it on YouTube. Mm.
Yeah.
Okay?
Facebook.
There is no way you going to tell me. And this is why, I'm saying this, I'm a puff pass. This is why I am trying to start something called Fuck the Radio. It is where a dude like David Banner can come on my show and say whatever he wants, do whatever he wants, get young artists to come to this conglomerate with everything. And we can do everything here. We can promote you here. We can put you on tour here. And you don't have to deal with the Giants anymore.
Everybody in the room is right. But the one thing that I learned, where's the CD at? People were tripping out that I went back to CDs. A lot of people was like, why are you doing that? And let me tell you why.
How much is that?
Whatever you want to donate, brother. Give me 10, 20, 30. No, I'm just I take whatever you give me, brother. Let me tell you why.
Who got a Sharpie? If he signed
whatever, I'm going to sign it regardless.
Okay.
But thank you.
Hold your thought. This attention, people who know David Banner personally. You are not supporting him if you don't do that.
Yes, you're right.
You're
and
not.
And I appreciate it. And gonna spend it in the right place. But listen, this is the thing that we don't think about. First of all, the internet and computers were meant to assist the man, not to think for the man. Mm. And the truth is, most of my fans, they live in Walmart towns. Mm. That's the reason why Walmart is so powerful.
Wow.
Like most of the folks that we touch, they're still bumping CDs in their car.
Anyway.
Like there's only a small amount of people, which are running the world right now, that are on the internet. But real people, real black people, they can't afford the internet. They don't have smartphones. Mm. Mm. So what we have to do is it has to be a conglomerate effort of what we all said. But this is the part that really bothers me, and I wanted to go back to what you said. I'm going to give everybody one. But this is the problem that I have.
I paid shit!
No. I appreciate it. And hopefully they're going to pay too after they saw what you did. But is it not amazing that black people allow the same system that they criticize to pick their leaders?
How about it? Yeah. Say more. No. How about it?
And look at the channels that we're getting our revolution from.
This is my point about. I totally get where Jeff is coming from, and I think in our minds we gotta have like a revolutionary soul. But I think at the same time the reality of stealing your radio and making you not have a projection voice, where your uncle owns the radio station, he gonna just put you on like Petey and see Talk to Me If You Haven't, the movie, kind of explains
great
it.
Movie.
And so I guess for me, coming back to it, I feel like we're not really understanding the gravity of what they did in 96.
Yes, they did.
And how that changed the mindset of young black men for a whole generation. You know, when I sat with Jerry Heller and had breakfast once, and he was explaining like NWA and Eazy-E. It wasn't all organized like in the movie. It was just a bunch of dudes who grew up hard, who wanted to show the world what it's like to grow up hard. Now, they like to take it and write it down as a business plan, and then have you get shot twice, and then have you on the corner selling dope to somebody, even though that might not be nothing that you went through, because that's what they're trying to do. They're trying to put out a certain image back to
selling a story.
Yes.
But what people don't understand, black people learn through something that's called tacit knowledge.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Most white people learn through explicit knowledge. Mm-hmm. That's the reason why they read and they record history the way that they do. Usually because we're tribal, it's passed down. Mm-hmm. It's something that's talked about.
It's moral.
They are always trying to create an algorithm for everything we do because we do soul music. Woo! We do soul cooking. And once we get you on Fruity Loops, once we hook you on the voice machine,
we got
an algorithm. Because think about it. Pop music wasn't a sound. Pop music was just popular music. Mm-hmm. But once they created an algorithm and a so-called pop sound, then that's something that they can regenerate, and then they can replace you.
Mm. Right.
That's all that they're trying to do.
They're trying to reduce soul to science.
Right. So you gave us Brandy. We'll give you Britney.
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah.
Friends?
I was there.
Would you say Friends with Queen Latifah show?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, Queen Latifah show.
You give us Hammer, we'll give you... Vanilla Ice.
And what I will say, Jeff, one last thing is back to the technology thing. I understand your point about technology being able to expand the amount of people that can use it. But we got to realize what's happening right now. These billionaires, you look at the Gawker case, you look at Buzzworthy, you look at Bezos buying Washington Post. You know, technology, as much as we believe can expand the amount of people who get access, it also can consolidate the amount of people who can control things. And I think we're seeing that in the internet space and not really being totally aware of it. Because what happened with the Gawker case with Hulk Hogan, basically they shut Gawker down. The guy funded Hulk Hogan's case and got Gawker shut down.
Right.
And so, like, this technology isn't always this space of opportunity.
Mm. So,
Bobby, Kev.
A minute ago, we were discussing they, them, those.
Uh-oh.
And...
Amir, I can. Here we come.
that's my heart. But what I'm getting at is this. We can make somebody that's very much flesh and bone mythical by referring to them as they, them, those. They become,
well, shit, they in here right now, Dr. G.
But he's flesh and blood. And when you see us and him in a room together, then that eliminates the myth. Right. Because he's not smarter than us. He's not better than us. He's a human being just like we are. And I think it's very important that we start breaking down the myth of Superman and recognize that wherever they got that one step at a time, one day at a time. And for us to reconstruct a narrative that supports our sustainability, it starts with changing our concept of who we are going up against. We're going up against human beings at the end of the day.
You know, Uncle Bob, a good example.
I don't know if that's fair to say.
A good example of what David Banner was talking about, how they get the best DJs. There's a documentary on Showtime called Stretch and Bobbito. And these were two DJs back from the early 90s. Who had a small little radio station out of Columbia University. And it wasn't a very powerful the signal wasn't very powerful, but pretty much every hip-hop artist who came through the 90s went through Stretch and Bobbito. They had to come there, they had to perform, they had to do, freestyle. And then their show was really big up until about 97, right, a year right after the Telecommunications Act, and Power 107, they bought them and brought them in, and then again, you started to see all the consolidation and the dying down of, or the commercialization of the hip hop towards that. So I was just going back to what David Banner was saying about that.
The thing really quick, I don't know if that's true. I don't even want to speak that into, I'm going to hold that. Just so y'all know, because I like people to know what's going on. I just heard one of my best homeboys just died. So like, I don't know if that's true. I just saw it on the internet. I hope that's not the case. But the reason why I put that out there, because sometimes, I remember one time a girl told me, she was like, David Banner, you acting funny today. And I look back at her and say, maybe because my dad just died. Because my dad had died that day. You know, people don't think, again, that we real live people that go through real live shit. And I'm just sitting here, I was looking for your tweet to retweet what you said. And then I'm looking through and they say, like, my homeboy dead. And I'm like, how can you even register that right in the middle of what's going on? But let me. I want to add something to what you said. I always tell black people want to be free, but they don't want to let go white people's toys. So we have to recalibrate what success is. Mm. Because when you say you want to be like somebody who has done what white society has done as a whole, we're talking about slavery.
That's talking about
Native American.
Yes.
So it's like, I tell black people all the time, you're going to fall too just by a residual effect if you continue to hang around that. So even me trying to sell 2 million, even though I know that it's possible, I don't look at it from that standpoint. If as a independent artist, I can clear 100,000 and I'm getting 80%? No, because I'm going to pay my people. Right. I get 50%. That's why I usually try to just clear 50%. And pay out the rest of it. Because I was going to tell you, that's the reason why I believe that your show is so successful. It's because you help. And so the universe conspires to pay you back. Like, literally by what we do. So in me saying that, dude, like, if instead of us wanting what they have, just slow down and build a foundation again.
So watch this.
We got a Jew on the show. Dr. Mark Goulston. And a lot of people be like, why is a Jew on the show? Why you got a Jew on the show? These conversations should be behind closed doors and us alone and blah, 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 blah. Listen, if your definition of success is authored by the Jew, guess what? You keep him in business. If you do what he's saying to do, what we've been saying to do, fuck running over there to Warner Brothers, RCA, Sony, whoever, and build it yourself, because now the internet allows you to do such a thing. Just like he said, I heard Steve, I used to work for Loud Records. I heard Steve Rifkin say it before. I don't have to sell, this album don't have to go gold. I would like it, because I'm going to be rich. I'm going to be even richer. But if the alcoholics sell 80,000 copies, we're doing billing. We're billing. Shit is getting paid for.
Well, what they don't know, though, is on that level that I found out, if you ship and we barely have stores anyway, but if the stores didn't send it back, the major labels were getting paid anyway. But the artists were not.
No.
Because they didn't know about it.
Oh, the artists had to pay.
for the buybacks.
But this, this the question.
But the label keep the bread. Mm.
So this is the question I got for you. My little bro, my little bro is 25, 26. He was at a club, BET events, Yo Gotti on stage. Everybody in the club watching Yo Gotti. Have we reached the point, due to Snapchat and Instagram, where the collective energy of the Earth, Wind, and Fire, and people are watching Yo Gotti, not because they appreciate his talent, but because they want to stand over everybody too one day. I want to see how I'm going to stand when I get my chance. He actually, one of his boys tapped him and said, I'm not watching him, I'm watching myself.
Oh, of course. Well, that's there's a great reason why everybody looks at rappers and goes, I can do that. Because the bar is so fucking low.
Mm.
Okay? When I fell in love with hip-hop, I can tell you where I was standing when I heard Rapper's Delight. I was in study hall, and somebody pressed play, and my life was changed after that. I knew then. I went home and tried.
Right.
I suck. I can't do this. That divide is gone because every bar we have is low. The pussy bar is low. All the low bars are low.
But that's why I was making that point. You can't blame the Jews for exploiting a situation that we kind of, at this stage of the game, helped create, helped sustain. So here's my thing. Yeah, they exploited us back in the 50s and the 40s, and they was robbing niggas that they publish it, and, you know, it was cold. But now if you go for that deal and you got your, because they'll come to you and ask you, what's your social media? How many people follow you on Instagram? How many people follow you on Twitter?
Because
what they trying to say is, if you already got your business set up, yeah, we'll jump into business with you.
Yeah.
When in effect, you don't need them to.
But I think, you know, I was part of the lawsuit against Rick Ross, the rapper with Rick. I represented Freeway Rick. And I think we think that artists have more bread than they have. And I think they actually often do need that support to actually exist on a national level. And sometimes I think scaling back and becoming more regionalized and understanding business a little more and understanding who your audience is, like what you did, and I commend you on that. Is what they need to do. Step away and really evaluate yourself, and then attack the people that's gonna hear the message that helps you the most.
But they don't want to give away them toys though. That's what I was saying. Yeah. That we want freedom, but don't want to give away the toys. Mm. That like the thing that I had to do. My mentor is one of the most powerful black men in construction. His name is David Moody.
Mm.
He said, son, I'm gonna teach you how to be wealthy.
Mm.
And the first thing he did is said, let me ask you a question, David Banner. He said, when you were hustling on the streets, did you let anybody count your money? And I said, no, sir. He said, so why in the hell are you doing it now? He said, I make 80 times more money, and he does. More money than, I know what all my money is, up to $2,000. And he started naming off. He said, how much your accountant get paid a month? He said, in order for you to be wealthy, you have to have a plan for it. The first thing he did is said, go. He said, a car is only supposed to be at most 12% of what you make annually. He said, go sell that fucking Bentley.
Mm.
He said, in order for you to own a Bentley, you need to make enough to buy three.
That's it.
I literally, and I want to show y'all.
Exhibit told me the same.
Keep going, but I want to show y'all something. Yes. Keep going.
Hey, listen.
I want to make a point.
Listen, we got to take a quick break.
Yeah.
But when we come back, Jeff's intellectual rant.
Mm.
The show is hot right now. This is crazy. We'll be back at 2.2.
Pop your black fist, pop your black fist,
pop your black fist, pop your black fist,
pop your black fist, pop your black fist.
These crackers got drones, they flying, they saucers. Keep your.
You are watching T Radio V, radio in TV.
Chapter 10, we talk about the difference between being embittered, embattled, or embittered. So, if you're embittered, of course you're holding on to things. You're resentful. You're resistant. If you're embattled, you're fighting. No, I don't accept that. I don't want that. But if
You're open and you're allowing the process to unfold and flower within you and beyond you, you have an opportunity to become embittered. And chapter 10 goes into detail on how to stop being embittered, how to stop looking for the win by being embattled, and how to evolve and expand to a space of embitterment. I mean, it's an incredible work, man, and I'm excited about it.
We're back. It's Politically Naughty with Mary Kay on TRadioV.com. I don't feel like it'd be as big of a deal these days if I, you know.
You'd be surprised. The most powerful weapon in the world is.
This is a no-holds-barred conversation.
So anyway, everybody started drinking my bath water. I loved it.
That is amazing.
Kitten, you need a movie about your life. If
maybe
Mary Carey was governor, we wouldn't be having these problems in America.
Exactly. Just exactly. Saying. I know.
Get Politically Naughty with Mary Carey, Mondays at 4 p.m. on T-Radio V.
You are watching T-Radio V. Radio in TV.
Okay, I cannot pretend that I am not giddy with excitement. I don't get excited about a lot of people because I'm an asshole, so I don't have many friends. But this cat to my right represents, if as much as we like to hearken back to the days of old, if we are in the land of Egypt and or Babylon, and there, and those who oppress us are Pharaoh. This brother right here represents Moses and our exodus from what it is that we are in. And something he has said today makes perfect sense to me. There is no one answer. There is no, like, we keep looking to, black people keep looking to leaders. Quick. Name the Japanese leader that everybody waits for before they do some shit. Quick, name the Jewish guy that everybody's waiting on. I'll give you Warren Buffett. Give me another one. We have to get out of the concept that one, that any of this is monolithic, that there's one way or there's one person or there's one Dr. King. Dr. King had something that is sadly absent amongst us now. He knew that what he was doing didn't have a goddamn thing to do with him, that he wasn't going to see it, that he wasn't. None of us really want to sacrifice a generation. We have to sacrifice. Those of you under the sound of my voice, a lot of what you're going to do is not going to benefit you at all. We have to get out of that. The concept that has really got us snowed is something I call the pig shit for pearls concept.
Here we go.
Okay? A lot of times you will be given something to do that is not unlike digging through pig shit for pearls. In my opinion, there are better places to find pearls than pig shit. Mm. We, to those who set this up, are not worth much more than pig shit. Mm. And what they do is they drop these pearls. Oh, you're broke? Well, Will Smith isn't broke. Well, Oprah Winfrey isn't broke. Well, Michael Jordan isn't broke. Those are the pearls in the pig shit.
Wow.
Stop ignoring the pearls. Stop ignoring the pearls. If you notice, kind of like what's going on with the music industry itself right now, what the brother was talking about with regard to if you on already, they got something for you. This was my problem with agents. Agents in this town are standing there next to you with gasoline. If you on fire already, they'll douse you with gasoline and your flyer gets bigger and you can buy more toys. Now, if you're not on fire, you're just going to drown in their gas. I'm done.
Jeff Brown's intellectual rant back in the building. Today's ZOWHAT morning show. We're talking about the Puffyization of Black America, man. What does that mean? Antonio Moore, give us the definition of Puffyization.
Yeah, man. You know, I really looked at it from a standpoint of just using time. You know, when I looked at Jay-Z, Baby from Cash Money, Jay-Z, Baby from Cash Money, Puff Daddy and Cube, I looked at their birthday, and they all was born in 69. And actually, if you look at Dre and Timberland, they was born in the same year as well. And the reason why that's important isn't a conspiracy theory. It's just timing. What it led to is that they were perfectly timed when the Telecommunications Act passed. And so they was that age. They were 26. I was 16. They were 26, so they were just young enough, and they had just been on enough that when the Telecommunications Act passed, and to be clear, what that did in a simple form is it took it from thousands of songs being on the radio throughout the country to basically maybe 100. And so that locked them in permanently, almost like till right now. And so that what also it did is it made opulence over normal stuff be played on the radio. So we got to a point where all these artists we're talking about is what you don't have and they have. And what it created is now a whole generation that's grown up with the idea of masculinity based around making other people feel bad. I got a article I did on All Hip Hop called "Conflicted Existence of Black Men," and essentially what I talk about is how black young men that don't even have jobs just want to be Superman. How about you just be a good pops today? How about you just be a good brother today? Take that with you.
Well, who's
go ahead.
Jeff? To say? And here's the only issue I take with that concept is that with regard to this thing that is the universe that American black people live in, we're being attacked by many dogs. That is just one of them, okay? I don't care what the radio plays. I have 50% custody of my children. My child support payments are now $16 a month. If I give that bitch a 20, she owe me $4. I have my children in my house. I don't care what's on the radio. Y'all finna listen to Roy Ayers. Y'all finna listen to Earth, Wind, and Fire. Okay? Because I am the filter, in the words of Chuck D. They ask me where I get it from. I get it from my pops. Because with a man in the house, the bullshit stops.
But that's the thing, though, Jeff. You grew up in a certain era. And, like, now we're so And I'm not using excuses. I'm just saying, when you got a kid that got Snapchat, got Instagram, and what you have is an onslaught that didn't exist when you were growing up.
True.
I'm not discussing that. No, I'm not. I'm agreeing with what I'm saying is that there is an absence of manhood that was mechanically designed before we inject this other shit that has to be looked at. You can't just say, well, there's this influx of shitty music. And yes, there's an influx. Music is horrible now. Music is horrible. I want to tape a brick to my hand and just go into record industries and just bash the motherfucker in the boardroom in the face with it because of what's on the radio. But there has to be a policeman that is, you can't ask the alligator to police itself.
There's an imperative right now. Irregardless of how we got there, we're here.
Thank you.
So the bottom line is, every day is a school day. I learned today that this brother right here, the reason he's able to sit here and be impactful in a marketplace that heretofore was outside of the realm is because he was influenced by an elder. You mentioned David Moody. I know who he's talking about.
Yeah.
And what he learned from that brother put him in a position where not only does he get a chance to make money, he
Thank
had a chance
you.
To keep money and then put it back into the hands of some young people who would otherwise be influenced by that get money thing and die trying mentality as opposed to constructing something that's sustainable. So however we got here, we are here. The only way back is one step at a time.
Dr. G?
Now, can I give David? Can I give you a marketing tip? Because I was just thinking through this.
You
want to get out there. It's what I call ITV, invitation to vent. When you give people an invitation to vent, and they vent, they're bonded to you. So if people want to support David Barron, here's the tweet.
Banner.
I'm sorry, David Barron. Here's the tweet you put up. I just listened to this. It blew my mind. Am I crazy? What do you think?
Invitation
to vent. So on those four statements, it invites people to say, wow, I don't know. So you're inviting them without pushing something at them, because everybody has so much stuff pushed at them, the energy is wrong. As soon as you feel someone's pushing something at you, you have to let go of something in your head, and there's no room. But if you make a statement, a declarative statement, I just listened to this, it blew my mind, am I crazy, what do you think? You may get some more traction.
I wanted to go back to something you said at the beginning of the show about the Brexit thing, and where does my place in that? Where does that leave me? And you know, I've said this on the show before, that the root of the problem of why most melanated people are treated the way they are in this nation is because of you're not telling people who you are. And so there's a movie, Ted, the little bear.
Yeah.
So Ted 2, if anybody's ever seen that. That whole movie deals with status, his status in law. He tried to marry a girl. He did it. Then they took it. They took the marriage away because
fucking bear.
Yeah, you're property. You're not a person.
You're full of fur.
So they had to go through this whole court thing where he had to try to prove his status, that he wasn't actually a person. They even pulled out the Dred Scott case where the
They used the Dred Scott case
in the movie Ted.
You lying.
And so about how the...
Somebody find that clip and tweet me on Twitter, at Zoe Williams. Tell me the truth. They used the Dred Scott case.
The Dred Scott case. The girl even said, she's like, how... She said, even going back to Dred Scott, how the slave, he sued to say that he wasn't property and he lost. That's not why he lost. He lost because of what he was calling himself. He entered the suit as an African descendant of African slaves. And so when the whole decision came back around, Judge Taney said, look, man, based on what you call yourself, we have no laws for you in our country, in the United States, in our government. Now, you know, it's not like you called yourself a Native American or someone from that nation who have their own laws, they're this, they're that. He distinguished the two differences, and he said, but you call yourself an African from descended from African slaves, so you have no status. And so this goes back to what's called connotative linguistics. And so where most people take the connotation of a word and think that's the actual denotation. So calling yourself black, most people don't understand that calling yourself black in law is literally death. You're telling the law, or you're telling the government, that you're not an actual person. If you go look up that color, it literally means that you're not real. And so, you know, whereas white, Even white is a connotative thing. So if you look at people who come from different countries, or black people who come from different so-called black people, they don't call themselves black. They'll say, I'm Nigerian, I'm Sudanese, I'm this and that. Right. But everybody over here want to be a crayon. And so when you're calling yourself a crayon, that's not an actual person in law. You need to have an actual status and then tell the government who you actually are.
Well, you know, at some point, and it's not in contradiction to what he's saying, because that foundation is very important, but we're dealing in the now. And the problems we have are so imminent, so right now, that we have to look at best practices. What is really working, and how do we connect to that in the now? For example, there are practices all throughout the economic landscape of success. The other night, CBS had the first fight in 38 years. What they didn't tell you was it was a brother put the card together by the name of Al Haymon. I done said this for the last 3-4 years, and people think it's not significant. We are winning certain battles, but we still follow old formulas. Mm-hmm. This brother has sit here today and gave young folks that want to get into the rap game a blueprint that they can control. Al Haymon had the first fight in 38 years on primetime television, and it was a major success. Now, are we going to get behind that model, get with another brother, him and my friends, Sam Watson, been rolling together for 38 years, and those brothers got down together and won? We have to figure out how to win wherever we are in whatever game we choose to play.
Jeff?
Wow. I just don't know. And I always agree with what you say about what we call ourselves. My only problem is you do it like an infomercial. You'll speak for like 20 minutes, and I still don't.
Well,
you got okay.
Well, not 20 minutes, 2 seconds.
Okay, no, you should start that out with call yourself Moors, and here's why. Get right to it. Because you always leave us with the crayon. I don't know what the fuck to call myself. My point, you always do that shit.
No.
There's this name you should call yourself, but I'm not going to tell you what it
that's
is.
That's not true, man.
$9.99 a month. I mean, holy shit. Hold it up. Like, goddamn. Would you stop telling me what not to do? Man, it reminds me of when I drove down the street with my ex-wife when she was my girlfriend. God, I didn't listen to the sign. What do you want to eat?
No,
what
said,
do you want to
oh,
eat? I want Chinese. Do you want Chinese? She goes, I'm hungry. I go, me too. She goes, I don't know what I want to eat. I say, well, do you want Chinese? No. Do you want Greek food? No. Do you want Italian food? No. Do you want hamburgers? No. All she could tell me was what she didn't want. You know what I learned from that? Definitively make a fucking decision when you're dealing with a woman.
I've said that many times.
No,
though,
you
I've
don't.
Said call your. Yes, I have. I've said your only the only free status that you have in on law, which has existed throughout time, is more.
Okay.
Now I'll say this.
Now,
though,
No. Before you say that, could you do me a little favor? The next time we discuss color or titles, could you pretty please with sugar on top? Start with that.
But you
holy
have to,
shit.
But you have to break. But I got to break through. I got to break through what people are doing. If I just come out and say you need to call yourself a more,
you don't.
What the fuck is that? Why are you gonna call yourself
that?
That
is out there.
So
you go.
I need to break down where the people
and
are
you
first.
Answer that question.
Like, dude, just go. Just really quick. I just need that, huh?
Let Antonio get in here real quick.
Hey, so somebody tweeted me about an image that I had did a chart, and it's called and they made a shirt out of it called the site is wearconsciousness.com. Told them I would say something about it. But it kind of goes back to what Bobby was saying, and I guess my opinion of we need to just start now is the gravity of this chart, the gravity of the time on this chart, and what they did during this time. This is the wealthiest country in the history of the world that was created during this time. If we don't start with a clear understanding of our limitations, what ends up happening is you just have scattered people benefiting from our own, I guess, ability to be taken advantage of. So okay. Is it better if you have a black man with a payday loan business than a white man with a payday loan business?
Yes.
And that would be your opinion. What I'm saying to you is that we're at a point now where if we don't understand our history, because that's where I think we need to really start, is history here in America and the history of how this country developed, we can't take advantage of America, nor can we understand some of the dynamics of what he was just saying about why our blackness is so limiting. And I think part of the pearls in Jeff's earlier statement is to keep us visually confused
about
our limitations so that we consistently blame ourselves.
Well, I got to respond to that real quickly, very quick. When I use modern day examples, it's because if you start with people you can actually talk to and actually get a feel for how they did what they did, then you can follow the trail back. Because we got some people that are doing it right now the right way. And that's helpful to know that if I'm going to get into something, there's somebody already winning right now using a sustainable formula.
But if somebody scratched a lottery ticket, they can't tell you how they won.
I'm not talking about luck. I'm talking about work.
But I'm saying Al Haymon got Floyd Mayweather, right?
No, that's not how he did that.
But the singular fighter played a major role in it, right?
No, it wasn't. No, Al started in the record business.
Come on, bro.
35 years ago, man. He didn't just get lucky with Floyd.
But wasn't that a major part of it?
That was a building point.
No.
That was a building point. He built to that. He dominated the record industry and live performance industry for 30 years. He
that's
didn't just get
saying.
With
so was
Floyd.
Al the guy that wrote the book about Michael Jackson?
No, that wasn't him.
Al Haymon is so fucking rich that if Puffy woke up with Al Haymon's money, he'd kill himself.
Damn.
I mean, if Al Haymon woke up with money,
Al Haymon can call himself any fucking thing you want.
And Al Haymon could walk up and spit on you, and you would not know who he is.
I think that's part of the genius.
To say that Mayweather is a big part of this is like saying that Chips Ahoy cookies make up Nabisco. No, they don't. Al Haymon has been hustling for a long time.
Almost 40 years.
On a grand scale.
So, but let's come back. Let's come back. Let's center this conversation again. I'm encouraged by what I saw on the BET Awards last night.
Absolutely.
With Jesse Williams. Right? But, as I said before the show began, Black people are pep rally people.
Woo!
We get hyped at a testimonial in church, but we only it's like Chinese food. It's like ideological Chinese food. We fool.
And forty-five minutes later,
we empty again.
Nigga, don't go cluck the grass.
Right. So my whole point is, how do we kind of gather this energy that we receive from pep talks like Jesse Williams last night? Cause everybody buzzing, Jesse Williams, Jesse. Okay, run, Jesse, run. All right, what we gonna do to support Jesse? What happens if the white American infrastructure he works for sees him as a threat and goes, no more $200,000 a week checks for you on this ABC show? How then are we going to uplift him?
Here's how.
Because it's not like we don't have the bread. Because all I'm saying is, if we look at this situation, no. Bottom line is, I know the numbers you put out, and those are real numbers, Antonio, and I want you to cover those again. Because that's something we need to understand. Like you said, start from where you are. Understand where you are. Understand the numbers. Understand the demographics. However, there is another number out there, whether it's 1.1, 1.4, 1.7 trillion dollars that we spend as consumers. So my point is, at some point, somebody in this crew got to come together and say, how do we redirect the current of that bread?
We don't.
How do we do that?
We can't.
So we could turn to say, hey, David, let's get David Godbox cracking the way it's supposed to. How do we get Zoe's asking for little money. How do we get Zoe's money so he can produce that? How do we get Jeff Brown's TV radio, fuck radio, off the ground? How do we get booty boxing where there's a fucking waiting list to go train with Kevin? How do we get fucking your law practice off the ground the way it's supposed to be? How does that happen when we do have that money?
How do we do that? With the black mindset that has been put on us in the past 450 or so years, we don't do that. When you say we don't. What happens is we start to find those like minds, and we take those like minds and grow more like minds. We don't go, hey, everybody, let's go to the beach. No, everybody's not going to go to the beach. Right. Motherfuckers in my house is going to the beach.
Right.
That's how you start. You have
this,
to start.
And this is my thing. You know, we've talked about it before, and Zoe and Jeff let me play the video. I interviewed Byron Allen. He's a close friend.
Shout out to Byron Allen.
And we talk like at least once a week for a long time.
He gets some bread.
We did an interview. I'm going to send it to you, David, so you can watch it. And one of the things that he brought was a lawsuit against Comcast, AT&T, mm-hmm. Chartered, FTC.
And won.
The thing that's interesting is we don't look at those pivotal moments and understand how impactful they are in being able to do the things that you just said, Jeff. If he had really won that Comcast one, no settlement, like outright, we're going to let you continue with the case. What that would have meant for black people is that we would have been able to go to these companies and say, how much business do you do with black people? Not like Puffy. And we talk about the Puffyization of black America. Another side of that is, we're going to give you 3% of revolt. We're going to give you 6% of revolt. But we're going to let you come out as the owner.
Right.
So that you look like you own this thing.
And black people.
And black.
Eat that shit up.
So the difference between Byron and Puffy is 100% black owned versus small percentage of black owned. And so that's the Puffyization, is you guys can be the entertainers on our station.
Oh, but hey, no disrespect. Ain't that Vlad TV too? Vlad TV comes to us, the YouTube, yeah. All the big names.
You don't even never see Vlad.
He interview everybody. He got 500,000 subscribers. He's averaging.
Sound like a nigga, just a Jew with a deep voice.
But my point is, he can then take that. Because of our participation, because we want to be stars, because our story needs to be told, he could take those numbers and go get the TV deal that we might not be able to get.
And this is why coming back to my point earlier about this tie-in between the six companies that got all the ownership during the Telecom Act and even the internet, they've created a funnel where you don't even know if Vlad is tied in with one of them.
You know what?
A farm lead.
But it goes back to, once you become enlightened, it's about momentum. I didn't know before today that this brother has a recipe that contradicts conventional thinking. In other words, instead of running toward the digital age, he went back to something that works for him.
Right,
that don't mean it's going to work for everybody, but if this brother's continued to have success, then that's one brother that we can get behind because he is actually producing wealth.
Yes.
And sharing the wealth. And the more, if five people leave this show today and talk to five people, the old
and so
effect,
on, so on. Yeah.
You'd be amazed, man, because we're talking about Jesse Williams. We weren't talking about him before yesterday. But the question is, what's the next step?
And he's been talking like that
for the longest.
Before yesterday.
Okay. Something he just did
wait,
brought up.
Real quick.
Yes, sir.
Make your point. And then take us to Banner's video. We got to play this video.
Okay.
Make your point and take us to the video.
The RZA talked about this. He's from a group called the Wu-Tang Clan.
I've heard of him. Yeah.
He said, don't be afraid.
Bobby has no idea.
Wu-Tang.
No, they get down with Boosie, man. That's what I mean by generational Wu-Tang. Connect, man.
Right. You say you don't have no friends. You have a new friend.
Okay. Don't be afraid to start small.
Yeah.
Nobody, I keep saying it, shit ain't bad enough for black people right now.
Yeah.
It's got to get even worse. And these two things, I keep saying, have to happen. The dollar, the thing we divide ourselves with. Niggas want to say they worship Jesus. No, they don't. They worship money.
Mm.
The dollar has to collapse.
Brexit.
And a rich black man has to be being chased by the same militia member that a poor black man is being chased by before niggas go, you know what? We all together. But until that happens, there's too big of a divide. If Mike Brown had been, and I'm guilty of this, Christopher, my brother, if them police had choked my brother out, bruh, this is my one fear. My one fear is that something is gonna happen to somebody that I love, and y'all gonna see Jeff Brown on the news the wrong way, because I'm telling you, those of you who monitor us, try me. If somebody I love blood gets spilled, oh man, helicopters, police, tapes, SWAT, a lot of shit is gonna be involved. I'm sorry. Brother Banner has a video. Watch this shit right here.
That's all the God box.
Yeah, black fist on the God box.
Watch this.
My bad.
I want y'all to watch this too.
Watch this right here.
Watch this.
Ooh, shit.
No, not me.
Jeff is 5 minutes.
The God box. Pump your black fist, pump your black fist.
Pump your black fist, pump your black fist.
Pump your black fist, pump your black fist. Pump your black fist, pump your black fist.
Pump your black fist, pump your black fist.
These crackers got drones, they flying, they sauces. Keep your white Jesus, don't pray to your crosses. They burning our churches, crip, pass me the Uzi. I know how to work it, I know how to squirt it. No Martin, no Luther, no King. No marching, no choirs, don't sing. The same Christian lovers that raped their grandmothers and hung our grandfathers from trees. They enemies, blood on the leaves, blood on the streets, blood on our feet. I'm sick of walking, sick of dogs getting sick on us. I'm barking, I'm sick of spitting written sentences. Listeners, don't get it.
The intent of this visual is not to promote violence, but to show that we as a people will no longer encourage and accept the loss of innocent black lives. The purpose of this message is not to target anyone, but instead to value everyone. This video is a statement and a reminder that black lives won't be taken lightly.
Well, disturbing dash cam video just released shows a white police officer killing a black teenager while on duty. We're going to show you the video in just a moment.
Absolutely. Now, I just don't see it where the gentleman's walking away from the officer and he just starts to open up on him. I just don't really see any scenario for that. If the guy turned around, attempted to throw the knife at the officer or attack the officer, that's one thing. Here, the video is clear evidence that the suspect was walking away and the officer just opened fire on him.
Now, Matthew, as someone in this field, what do you see when you watch this video?
Well,
he's guilty.
I'm in the booth, bro. Give me 5 minutes.
These crackers got drones, they flying they saucers. Keep your white Jesus, don't pray to your crosses. They burning our churches, quit pass me the Uzi. I know how to work it, I know how to squirt it. No Martin, no Luther, no King. No marching, no choirs, don't sing. The same Christian lovers that raped their grandmothers and hung our grandfathers from trees. They enemies, blood on the leaves, blood on the streets, blood on our feet. I'm sick of walking, sick of dogs getting sick on us. I'm barking, I'm sick of spitting written sentences. Listeners, don't get. Because they got chains on their brains and that ain't no diss. Shout out to Tick.
Pump your black fist, pump your black fist.
Pump your black fist, pump your black fist, pump your black fist.
Pump your black fist, pump your black fist. Pump your black fist, pump your black fist.
Pump your black fist, pump your black fist, pump your black fist.
Pump your black fist, pump your black fist.
I ain't African, I'm Ethiopian. Put them raw seeds in the fallopians. You can hope I win, ho, I hope I lose. Bitch, long as we made it true, I hope again. I hope I get into heaven, I hope we forgive it. I hope Jesus, far as I know, look like near. Do I know when I see Florida heavens, them sevens, I weigh in them sixes. I'm staying religious, but we stay in the trenches. And got to play with they liches, then came to my senses. I bet them crackers never came through my fences. You burn up your cross and I burn up your corpse. And I turn and bang and do the same to the witness. Hang them and dangle them in the street looking up at his feet. So you never forget this, we did this for Martin and Malcolm. Even Mandela, Jimmy Lee Jackson and them nigga Evers. For Clyde Kinnard, hard labor slaving in the yard. For Huey, for Hampton, for Bobby, we got it. For Jordan Davis, we gon' play this. For Sandra Bland, we gon' stand. I'm still out of stomping. For Janaea Thompson, from the coast to Compton, it's low.
Pump your black fist, pump your black fist.
Pump your black fist, pump your black fist, pump your black fist.
Pump your black fist, pump your black fist. Pump your black fist, pump your black fist.
Pump your black fist, pump your black fist, pump your black fist.
Pump your black fist, pump your black fist.
Watching T Radio V, radio in TV.
What did you play opposite Andy and Eric? Do you remember?
Andy and I worked as two employees at a network.
Okay. Oh, you're and forgetting the other thing.
I played a news anchor and he played a reporter.
Okay, but the other thing you did, the thing you did on the Andy Dick show, who did you play to Andy?
Oh, is that gonna play my sister?
You played his wife, Denise.
Yeah.
Yeah, you played his wife.
Yeah. So what's wrong with that, Eliza? Yeah.
Nothing's wrong with it.
He's got a great range as an actor.
Yeah, it just was funny.
Encounters with Eric and Eliza Roberts, Wednesdays from 2 to 4 p.m. on T Radio V.
T Radio V.
And it's Mary Carey, of course, politically naughty with Mary Carey.
I'm always naughty. I'm always politically. My behavior is always politically naughty. I'm never politically correct. Dr. Drew, hi. Oh, I'm so
excited. How are you? It's all teary-eyed, doctor.
I know. She wishes she could live at rehab.
But only if Dr. Drew's there. Obviously, sure. Plus one, like, you know, because a little too groping might be inappropriate, but I like the flirting and stuff.
When I walked in, you shoved my head in your...
No! Are you going to sue me?
Get politically naughty with Mary Carey, Mondays at 4 p.m. on T-Radio V.
You are watching T-Radio V. Radio in TV.
People say that they know the media. I didn't know that shit was real until I went to Ferguson. Well, I'm literally watching one thing happen and I'm watching CNN lie. Like, the problem was the cops. And the only reason why people acted like they acted the first day is because America don't pay attention until we do some shit. Ferguson has been treating them people the way that they have been treating black people that way. And what I told people Ferguson was, Ferguson was a beacon of light to tell people all around the world that we need help. Look at what these white folks are doing to us. Now, we've been complaining all the time in our music, in our videos, but people don't seem to care or matter until their buildings start burning. But Ferguson has always been, it has always been racial tension between the cops and black folks.
And just to give him a tag, because we just talked about this with Ferguson, you know, they did a study and they showed that they had like 12,000 residents and like 30,000 arrest warrants. They had, St. Louis had about 80, I guess, warrants for every 1,000 citizens, whereas Ferguson had almost 600 for every 1,000 citizens. Wow. Almost all black people. And then when you go to court, you go to court at a house at night in the cold, and you got to stand outside. This is the reality.
So this is the final thought. I'm just going to wrap right here.
All
right. Y'all saw that. Y'all wasn't listening. Oh. It's fine. But this is the final thought, just to summarize and wrap this show up. This is what disappoints me about everything. You know, there's hope, but then there's also despair at the same time. Yes. The white man is a cold motherfucker. He got a cold system, right? You got to behave a certain way because you can't come across as somebody that is aggressive, you know, the new word, you know, aggressive or defiant, right? You can't stand for shit.
Militant.
Okay, militant is another word. Ali was the perfect example of a militant black man. Now, does that mean he was a part of a military? No. Militant just mean, motherfucker, I'm not going for your bullshit. And just because you want me to, and nothing you can dangle in front of me as a carrot is going to cause me to bend my fucking knee. And my people are with me, my wife, my children, we'll all go hungry together on this principle. So what the system do? Adjust. For the new nigga that act like that, we gonna circumvent all the motherfucking resources we have entangled in his life. Well, how do the resources get entangled in your life? It gets indoctrinated as standards of living. Right? Motherfucker, you better be married. You better have a family. You better do this. You better go to school because all that shit ties you into their system of control. Now, am I saying I'm anti-family? No. Am I saying I'm anti-marriage? No. What I'm saying is the way it is constructed through the Western system, through Western sociology, it ties your ass. It binds you. So guess what? Now you, nigga, you coming to the table for compromise, for negotiation now. Because I can begin to start pulling shit based off of how you're integrated into the matrix. So now what?
Can I tell you real quick the reason why I know you're telling the truth? I've always wanted 7 kids. The reason why I don't have a child yet is because I know once I have a child, shit is going to have to be compromised.
Right.
So as a man, knowing what I'm dealing with, I'm not even going to put myself in that situation.
How about it?
Until I have the freedom to do whatever the fuck that I want to do.
Right.
And they make you feel like if you don't have these things that's in the this construct, that you are a fucking failure.
That you're a failure.
They make a rapper feel like if you don't go, you're fucking, that's not the fucking truth.
Right.
Listen, if you can maintain your life doing art, I'm around this bitch rapping and speaking and fucking getting paid.
How about it?
Even if I'm only able to maintain my monthly living.
I'm good.
You're more than fucking ahead. Yeah. My dad, listen, our parents,
come on,
they just wanted to get a job that fucking paid.
That was consistent.
Right. Whatever the fuck they can do.
How about it?
What is the dream? My dad looked at me and said, motherfucker dreaming? I tell people this all the time. How can black folks dream when you don't have a fucking bed? You feel me? So, like, I just want people to know, I know we're closing, bro. Y'all said something that I wanted to say, and I got to leave it here. One of the reasons why people don't want to start their business at the bottom is because we're so fucking selfish. And somebody told me, you may be the Moses to give Jesus an opportunity to thrive.
Uh-oh.
And I'm not a religious person, but I speak in the tongues can understand.
This is a marathon.
But everybody wants to be Jesus.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Everybody wants to start a Jesus.
What if I may not be the actor that I want to...
John the Baptist?
Right.
I just came to bring the dude through.
God damn it. Don't nobody want to be Silas, Peter, or Timothy.
Right.
Right.
Come on.
So I may be the person. I may have to sacrifice for a generation so that they can come through and do whatever the fuck they want to. Mm.
Now, let me come back. Cash Mob. Let's make an impact today. There's a standing audience of thousands of people right now watching this show. If everybody doesn't get the God box, what was you here for?
Mm.
What were you here for? David said it earlier, if our community don't support our leaders, then our leaders are following the agenda of the people who do financially support them. So here we are saying, this brother has a message, this brother has a mission and a purpose. What are we going to do, just get the jewels for nothing and keep it pushing?
And ladies say he's very attractive.
And then there's that. The ladies are on him. Now. And then there's that.
Really quick, when I was coming here, the TSA pulled me to the side and they pulled me off in the room. And I was like, dog, is this some racist shit? Like, I haven't done anything. And they said, how dare you bring weapons of mass destruction in this motherfucker?
Don't get a weapons. Go open it.
Listen, I just want to reiterate this point real quick. This is not a pep rally.
Mm.
My man.
I'm just tired. Farrakhan, he whips us up good. And I love the minister. But the minister sometimes reminds me of Krishnamurti. Krishnamurti, of course, is one of my favorite philosophers. Bruce Lee followed him. So many wealthy, high-end motherfuckers followed him. Krishnamurti, M-U-R-T-I. And the Hindus say it correctly. It's not Murti, it's Morti, right? Morti,
didn't
right?
know how to spell it with an O.
But Krishnamurti says something to his nephew on his dying bed, on his deathbed. His nephew saw him and was like, man, he looks real frail. He looks gone. He was almost dead. And then he came to Krishnamurti and he said to Murti, he said, how are you? And he said, I'm fine. And then Krishnamurti asked his nephew, he says, sir, can you tell me where your anchor is? And his nephew said, well, it's in you. And then Krishnamurti sat up and cussed his ass. I mean, the nephew said he It was almost like he went back in time and got younger and sat up and said, motherfucker, I wasted my whole fucking life teaching and preaching and getting you guys to understand that it's about you accessing God within and then connecting that God
to other people.
Do you understand? Because it's the same shit. But if you didn't see it and your anchor is in me and I'm on the way out, you missed the whole point. And sometimes I think for Farrakhan, he getting up there in age, brother's in his 80s looking beautiful. But sometimes we just need this fucking pep talk and then we revert back to who we are. We respect Farrakhan in his face, but stand in line and stand in place in front of the white man. You know, we agree with Farrakhan. But then, no, I ain't gonna fuck this gig up because of some shit Farrakhan said.
I can't listen to Farrakhan at work.
I'm not finna fuck this situation up. And I'm telling you, there's enough of us to make a difference today, right now, if we supported everything everybody in here is doing. That's all I gotta say, man. Bobby, where can they find you?
At Glanton Smith is my Twitter handle. My website is www.realmendontplay.com. A brother called me, he reached out today and said, I read your book and I love it. I didn't write this for me, I wrote it for us. Real Men Don't Play.
Excellent, we gotta do this quickly, guys. Kev?
RealNagas.com, that's RealNagas. I have some new Phoenix Moore and Dragon Moore shirts.
Yes.
For everybody. To the people who bought some already, thank you. If you take a picture in them, send it to me and I'll put it on the website.
Excellent.
Antonio Moore, find me at Tone Talks on YouTube. Make sure you pick up my man's shirt. He sent it out for me. And also pick up the other dude's book, Capitalism, The New Segregation.
Got to get that. Dr. G.
Yep. At Mark Goulston, MarkGoulston. And go to Amazon and you'll find all kinds of books.
My favorite is Get Out of Your Own Way. Yeah, that shit is fucking hot monkey lava.
Yeah, and, or come to my website, markgoulston.com.
I wouldn't call it monkey lava, but it's really good. Thank Jeff Brown.
Thank you, Quincy.
Jeff! God damn it, I didn't listen to them. I got 5 kids already, so I'm selling books. I make beats. I'm neutering puppies. I'm selling incense. I got... You come to my house, I got an ice cream truck with every fucking thing on it. But for right now, every other Wednesday, I'm hosting a show at the lounge at Roscoe's Chicken and Waffles. And before I get off of this, before he leave this building... I'm doing something other than beats. I got some hot beats. I'm gonna do some other stuff with this brother here. God damn it!
All right, listen. This is really important to me. the GODBOX lecture series is selling out all over the United States. People have been asking where it's gonna be. July 23rd. We're gonna be in Boston. We're working on it, brother. July 9th. We're gonna be in Washington D.C. Everybody's waiting on that one for obvious reasons.
Yeah.
Houston, Texas, September 4th, we're going to be there. You can go to Eventbrite or Ticketmaster to check out any of those.
Yeah.
Charleston, South Carolina on July 16th. Chicago, y'all hurry up. It's already selling out. Yeah. Eventbrite, July 7th, the Promontory in Chicago. And where else am I going to be? Let's just hold on that right now. And I appreciate y'all. My name is David Banner.
Yeah.
Pre-order the GODBOX. There it goes.
Yeah.
Hell yeah.
God damn it.
I'm in this motherfucker. And Zo, bro, honestly, man, I'm proud of y'all, man. Like, this is a very dope show, very dope concept, man.
Thank you, brother.
And more than anything, look, I love the way that you push it outward.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? You make it not be about you. Like, you just sat here. And you allowed the show to be, you're just a conduit for the people
right.
to do better, brother. And you're a very, very good example of what we all should be doing. And I even thought about it, like, damn, I should have been more prepared. There's so many businesses from Mississippi that I could have pushed.
Yeah, man.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Yeah.
People don't do what you're doing, man.
Right.
So I'm very proud of you, and I'm glad to meet each and every one of you all, man. Thank you.
Listen, get my book. The Relationship Dismount. This is David's copy.
Let me hold it so I don't look like you pushing.
The Relationship Dismount, How to Stick the Landing When Exiting a Toxic Relationship. Also, you can get it at IamZoeWilliams.com. It's on iBooks. It's on Kindle. Please, please, cash
mob
it.
Wait, you have to change this picture. It look like you're looking at me, dog. Look at our picture, dog.
It's them damn green eyes.
Somebody said I look like a ghost from the 30s. I love it. Please get the book. Also, I need you guys to cash mob my Indiegogo campaign, Zoe Williams' new book, The Holographic Relationship. I have a new campaign that's up right now. Please support it. Go there now. We need help for the second book, The Holographic Relationship, a deeper look into the relationship between spirituality and intimate communion. It's going to be a very powerful book. I appreciate everybody for tuning in. We about to bounce like bad checks. Next week, we got another heater. Holla!
You lied. My Uzi weigh a ton. I bought it. Fully out the form and they come. My Uzi weigh a ton. I bought it. Got nobody guard. My Uzi just need mighty guard. My Uzi got nobody guard. My Uzi just need mighty guard. My Uzi weigh a ton. Pray to God to stay protected. High alert. I see jackers on the creep in my reflection. Law ain't nothing been promised late. Police out your acting crazy. Shooting up black folk left and right. People out your die every night. Mama worry about me all the time cause I'm grind. Trying to make a move cause the government don't give a fuck about pro folk. I just paying dude trying to keep the food on my table. My family fed in my mind right. And I attitude adjust like the motherfucker wants.
You are watching T-Radio V. Radio and TV.